Thank you so much for the opportunity to be here and also to be in one shared talk with Michael Umbrella.
These are my disclosures. So I guess I will be in the next 15 to 20 minutes address the clinical and immunological hallmarks of systemic JIA and where possibly linked to other autoinflammatory diseases, whereas Mike Umbrella will discuss the immunogenetics. So I'd like to show this picture. This is actually a painting of Caravaggio, almost 400 years old, and potentially one of the first images or clinical descriptions of a child with Still's disease. And I have to say that my, although I try to generalize, my view might be a little bit biased by the fact that we sample and also treat our patients in quite a peculiar way. We have a prospective cohort since almost 11 years now with a standardized follow-up, but also with a standardized treatment. I'll come back to that later. So as you all know, the classification criteria for systemic JIA are still clinical. And this is still a diagnosis of exclusion per ILA criteria, which is still a bit hampering, I think, the diagnosis, the diagnostic process, but also makes that this is quite a heterogeneous disease. And this comes from the fact that the differential diagnosis in these children, who are very sick at onset, as you, most of you know, is very broad. You should think of a variety of infections, both bacterial, viral, but also really specific infections like leishmaniasis. You should think of malignancies and of other inflammatory disorders, including the periodic fever syndromes. I like this figure that was first proposed, actually, the concept of a disease continuum by Dennis McConnell almost 10 years ago, and it was a bit refined in the second figure on the right by the same group, in which it shows that systemic JIA is really a prototypical autoinflammatory disease in the spectrum of other autoinflammatory diseases, while not being a monogenic disease. So this means that you can do a variety of diagnostics at disease onset, or you should do a variety of diagnostic, and this ranges from simple things, blood count, the differentiation, maybe autoantibodies. For sure, infectiologist investigations, cultures, PCR and serology. Most of the times also imaging. You should at least consider screening for malignancy depending on the age of the patient and of the signs of that might suggest also a malignancy. And you should think of genetic tests. And we are clearly in need of good biomarkers. And I will briefly discuss some of potential biomarkers that we also have been using and others as well. Some of these are IL-18, which I will address, but there are also others. So these are clinical manifestations in our cohort in the past 11, 12 years. So all of these patients present with a really striking fever pattern. It's almost always a spiking pattern, although not always. I think slightly less than half of them present with skin manifestations that can vary, sometimes macropapular, but also sometimes really subtle. About one-fifth show generalized lymphadenopathy, at least in our cohort. A little bit more signs of increased size of the spleen and or the liver. In our cohort, about one in eight patients have signs of pericarditis on ultrasound or exthorax. And this is very interesting. To my opinion, not all of those patients have arthritis, at least not at onset of the disease. And some of them will develop later. But I think this is under debate now, also in the new proposed classification criteria of Martini et al. Earlier this year. The idea was proposed that arthritis is not a prerequisite anymore for the diagnosis of systemic JIA. And this is actually supported by data of our group, in which we divided our cohort in patients presenting with arthritis from disease onset, and we also identified 12 children from whom, after thorough investigations, we are really sure that they are having systemic JIA, but did not present with arthritis at the first weeks of their disease. And as you can see, all of the laboratory parameters, ESR, CRP, ferritin, lymphocyte counts, But also the more sophisticated IL-18, soluble IL-2 receptors, and also the clinical symptoms, they do not vary or differ from those patients who present with arthritis at onset. So what are the immunological hallmarks of this disease? We have heard from Virginia Pascal this morning, her beautiful data stemming from 2004 and 5, that systemic JIA is for sure an IL-1-driven disease, although it's very difficult to measure elevated levels of IL-1 in the disease. It took her a stimulation experiment of serum with of systemic JIA patients that she co-cultured with healthy control monocytes to show that this is an IL-1-driven disease. And actually, another cytokine is highly increased in peripheral blood of those patients. And this is a cytokine of the IL-1 family. It's IL-18, as you can see here. IL-18 is a strong stimulator of NK cell lytic function. It induces perforin and also the expression of interferon gamma by NK cells. It has very it's very similar to the IL-1 receptor signaling pathway in the sense that it's caspase 1 dependent, and the signaling pathway is quite similar, and also the receptor has some similarities. As with IL-1, which has a natural occurring inhibitory protein, also IL-18 has a naturally occurring inhibitory protein, IL-18 binding protein. These are also data from our group, but this is also confirmed by others, in which you can see here that healthy controls have low levels of IL-18 levels in peripheral blood. Disease controls, polyarticular JIA, also have low levels. And active systemic JIA patients have really highly increased levels of IL-18. And note that this is a log scale. When they are in remission, they are strikingly lower. Unless that 18 is a stimulus of NK cell lytic function, the figure on the right shows that the lytic function of NK cells measured by an NK cell lytic assay, in which you label a target cell line with a radioactively labeled protein, the NK cell function is actually significantly lower than of healthy controls of polyarticular JIA patient. And moreover, whereas in healthy controls you can increase the lytic function of NK cells by adding IL-18 to the assay, this has no effect on the NK cell lytic function in systemic JIA patients. So we discovered a couple of years ago that this defect of the IL-18 NK cell axis is actually reversible, and it's lying in the IL-18 receptor beta unit, which shows a phosphorylation defect, which is reversible after treatment with IL-1 blockade. So in that same experiment, in that same cohort, we did some measurements on the inflammasome activity of our patients, also relating to the autoinflammatory diseases, of course. And we found some evidence that constitutively there is an increased activity actually of caspase 1, as you can see here, compared to healthy controls. And if you stimulate with LPS and ATP, you can, of course, in healthy controls, increase the caspase 1 activity. You can also increase that in systemic JIA patients, but then the difference is not significant anymore. He has shown that the effect of the defect of the NK cell IL-18 axis is reversible. Again, now by measuring interferon gamma as a readout of NK cell lytic function, this is restored as normal interferon gamma levels again after treatment with anakinra. So what are we know that NK cell function is deficient in most of the systemic JIA patients. What are the other cells involved in systemic JIA? And here you can see at disease onset, we see strikingly elevated levels of neutrophils in systemic JIA patients, also of some monocytes, not so much of the lymphocytes. And here you can see after treatment that the neutrophil counts quickly normalize within days of NK cell of anakinra treatment. The number of neutrophils correlates strongly with S100 proteins, so inflammatory calcium binding proteins expressed in granulocytes in humans. So we found that not only are the neutrophil counts increased in systemic JIA patients, they are also primed, as you can see by decreased levels of expression of CD16 and 62 ligand, and increased levels of CD64 and CD35. And they are not only show an activated phenotype, but they also show increased vesicle degranulation and rust production, as you can see here, in red, active systemic JIA patients, and in blue, patients in remission with controls in black. So the neutrophils in systemic JIA patients early in the inflammatory phase are increased, are of a primed phenotype, and are really active. So we did an RNA sequencing experiment with three systemic JIA patients in which we isolated or sorted actually neutrophils from. Neutrophils are very fragile cells, and we had three healthy control samples beside that. And as you can see here, the top, the differentially expressed genes were all related to immune responses. And actually, sorry, if you compare them to a known data set of sepsis patients, you see quite strikingly similarities between active sepsis patients and active systemic JIA patients. So what is the effect of a typically IL-1 mediated disease therapy, anakinra? And as I said, since 2008, we treat our patients in a really prospective way, in a standardized measure. We don't treat them upfront with steroids. The first treatment is anakinra, if they fail at least a couple of days of treatment with NSAIDs. And we only start steroids if they do not respond completely to anakinra in the first weeks of their disease. So if they fail to resolve their fevers, we increase the doses of anakinra after 1 week. And if they do not completely respond to anakinra, then we either start steroids besides the anakinra, or we switch to other cytokine therapies. And we did that with 42 patients in the past 10 years, and here are the results. Not only see we really an inactive disease in most patients at 3 months and at 12 months, but with this strategy we can get a really high percentage of patients off medication within the first year of treatment. This is also shown over here. So inactive off medication, of course, impossible by definition after 3 months, but after 1 year, more than half of them, and almost 3/4 of them after 3 and 5 years. And inactive on medication, about 1/4 of them remaining after 3 years and 5 years. And only a very limited number of patients needed to start steroids or switch to other cytokine-directed therapies. And this strategy has resulted in the decreased use of corticosteroids, and also, besides, along with that, of course, with a decreased signs of steroid toxicity. So we have normal growth in our cohort of patients, hardly any obesity, and really good bone scores. And also the patient-reported outcomes in the lower half of the table show very good response rates with this strategy. So conclusions of this part. I think systemic JIA is a complex autoinflammatory disease sharing important features with other IL-1 mediated diseases. To my opinion, arthritis is not a required criterion for the diagnosis of systemic JIA. And the treat-to-target approach using first-line treatment with anakinra, like other IL-1 mediated diseases and autoinflammatory diseases, shows really high response rates at in the first year of treatment, but also results in good outcome measures after 3 or 5 years of follow-up, with more than half of the patients off therapy. And important challenges, of course, in systemic JIA remain, specifically how to develop personalized treatment and how to prevent and treat complications, which I did not discuss today, like macrophage activation syndrome, which will be addressed in a different talk, and interstitial lung disease. And with this, I would like to end and thank
my team in Utrecht.